must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning. Glad to be with you. Well, today is kind of a milestone for me. Today is the 19th and last episode in the series of The Value of a Dollar, My Memoirs and How I Learned the Work Ethic. I want to thank each one of you that have followed along with me telling my life story with the purpose on hoping that each one of you will benefit from it and have a better life, hopefully because you got to know me a little bit better. Today is episode 224. Right Thinking with Steve Coplon is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called The Most Blessed Person I Know. Tune in and hear Steve express his thanks for the wonderful life that he has been given and how, despite a lifetime of distractions and setbacks, he is now finally living his purpose. You know, as I look back at these 18 episodes prior to today, I think I'm trying to have each one of you know that as we go through hardships and adversities, we just got to keep on going, trust in the Lord. And I think I've done a good job of sharing with you my adversities, a lot of my different things I've done to earn a living and keep my bills paid and stuff like that. Well, today I'm going to take a little bit different tack. But first, I'm going to go back and just think about a couple of the better things that happened when I was doing my marina experiences and when I was doing the Pelican Point Village real estate deal that was such a financial disaster. When I was in Pelican Point, when I was trying to build a nice community, one neighbor at a time, I rented a bus and I took the community on field trips three different times. We came from Elizabeth City back into Norfolk to the Virginia Stage Company one time to see a performance of Ella, the music and life of Ella Fitzgerald. That was a wonderful, wonderful evening. One time I brought 50 or 60 people to see a baseball game in Harbor Park to see the Tidewater Tides, or the Norfolk Tides, I guess they changed their name along the way. And that was a wonderful thing to be bringing all these people to a baseball game. And then another time we took a bus tour to go see the Lost Colony in Manio, North Carolina. And it was just wonderful. I really did make a lot of friends down there in Elizabeth City. And despite all the disastrous financial circumstances that we went through in that deal, there were some wonderful people down there. And I just don't want you to think that I'm just down there struggling. I'm down there trying to make friends and build a nice community. Well, when I was in the marina deal, I did those fishing tournaments that I told you about a little bit. And one of the best things that ever came of that happened a few years later after I finished the marina deal. I had a man come to me. His name was Rodney. And Rodney was one of the pastors at New Life Christian Church, New Life Christian Center, actually, in Ocean View. And he invited me to come to a tent revival they were having. And I went, and it was just a beautiful, beautiful experience. Absolutely filled inside that tent with the Holy Spirit. And then that church asked me, would I be the host to do the same fishing tournament at a community rec center right around the corner from New Life Christian Center? And because they loved the way that I'd done that fishing tournament. And that's how Don and I got started in a whole new chapter of our lives, where we left Tab Church that we had been teaching Sunday school at for about 5 or 6 years. Kindergarten class. And I started attending New Life Christian Church, and Donna wasn't ready to go there. So I would go there and split my time between Tab Church, where Donna was still wanting to attend. And then I got her to finally come down to New Life and be involved, and she loved it too. And then we started going there regularly, and I got to tell you, the music there, the worship music was like nothing we had ever experienced. We just absolutely loved it. We spent about 6 years there, but it all started because Rodney invited me to come do that fishing tournament. And that was a wonderful thing. We loved it down there, made a lot of friends. Well, what I want to talk about here also is that a lot of the things that affected the direction of my life was my health, as you've heard in all these previous episodes, and insurance, health insurance. That has always been one of the most important things that I have to deal with in my life. When I left Cruise International, I was able to stay on their health insurance for a number of years until I settled the tax issues in the state of New York. I think you might remember that story. And then when I got into the marina, when I left the marina, I was able to stay on the marina insurance through what they call COBRA. But then I had to get into an individual policy for myself, which was $2,700 a month. And I couldn't sustain that for very long. So a man that I met there named Jim Blassingham, who was our health insurance and general liability agent at the marina, I called him up and discussed my situation for needing insurance. And he said, you know, Steve, why don't you come to work for us in our financial services company, get your licenses that you'll need, and then that way we'll sponsor you and we can get you on our health insurance. I had to get on an insurance program that was more than 100 people so that I wouldn't be individually rated. When you've got a terminal illness, it's very hard to get onto an affordable policy, but it's critically important because you can't afford medical care the best that you can, that you're going to need without having good insurance. So I got my licenses, all the basic licenses to get into the life, health, accident, I think they call it. And so I got my insurances. I think it was called a Series 7. And I went to work with them. And I was providing introductions to people that I knew. I knew a lot of people at that time of my career. And so I had a very good health insurance policy there. And then about a year later, it just wasn't for me. I left there and was doing more general consulting with the Small Business Development Center again. And this was before I got into my nonprofit. I was doing the real estate deal, though. We started the Elizabeth City real estate deal immediately after I left the marina. But so I left the insurance company, the financial services company, and went on COBRA with them for a while. But then I needed insurance again. And, you know, one of my closest contacts in my life that I've always been close to, his name is Ed Lee. He was at the YMCA as the fitness director about the same time that I started teaching karate there in 1972. And now here we are, you know, 35 years later or so. And he's like a senior vice president there. And they made him the first chaplain of the YMCA in Hampton Roads. And we were very close friends. And I talked to him about my insurance problem. And the Y was going to hire me to work a minimum number of hours. It might have been 30 hours a week that would qualify me for their health insurance program, and just let me be in there and just sort of put away weights, do different things. I mean, I was always already teaching karate as a volunteer, but they're going to let me be involved just to get me on their payroll so I could have insurance. But it turned out that I didn't need that opportunity, and I got onto another insurance program. But what I'm just pointing out to you is that I've always had to deal with a lot of insurance issues to make sure that I keep coverages. And then I had a couple life insurance policies, And I've talked about one of them earlier. It was a policy that I had that was what you call a universal life that had a cash value buildup. And I tapped into that policy off and on and borrowed money and then paid it back when I could. And I kept that policy in force all the way through. But I had another life insurance policy that I was very fortunate to get. And it was $1 million term policy that I got months before I got diagnosed at 51 years old. I was actually 50 with my multiple myeloma, my terminal illness that's incurable. And what a blessing it was that I was able to get that policy. And so that became my estate. That was going to fund my estate. When they gave me 5.5 years life expectancy and they said, well, you know, we've had patients last as long as 8 years. I'm like, oh, wow. And they told me then that, you know, just live your life, Steve. Don't think about it. And it's like, that's easier said than done, I guess. But at that time, I didn't think I was ever going to live to see my any grandchildren. Well, fast forward, I got 8 grandkids now. Beautiful, beautiful kids. And so that's a blessing. But I had to go for years not knowing if I was ever going to get to that stage of my life. Well, during this time, I had this term life insurance policy, and I eventually found out that they have a thing called a life settlement where you can there's groups of people out there that will buy life insurance policies on terminally ill people, give you a payment to buy your policy, name them the beneficiary so that when you die, they'll get the death benefit. Well, I'm not going to go into too much detail on how I did that, but it took about 5 years because the first time I tried to get someone to take over my policy, I couldn't afford the premiums. The premiums got extremely expensive. Term policies after a while, I had a level premium for 10 years at $1,340 a year. But on the anniversary of the 10th year, it went up to $1,000 the first year, $1,100 a month rather. You know, it was like it was getting very, very expensive. And so that policy ended up costing me over $18,000 a year to maintain. And I finally was able to sell it. But the first time we put it out there, I had an agent that specialized in placing these kind of policies. They gave me a life expectancy a lot longer than what I thought. The actuarial tables came back and they said, because I was doing so well fighting this cancer, they gave a much longer expectancy. You had to have less than 10 years in order to have the policy be able to be sold. And mine came in at 17 years. And this is a really weird thing. I'd already lived 11 years with the cancer that they gave me. Basically, the average was 5.5 years. And so I didn't understand why they could say, hey, you got another 17 years. It's just actuarials. And they'd studied all my medical records extensively. And that would have given me about 28 years from the time I first got diagnosed in 2001. And so I appealed it. And my family thought that was the weirdest thing in the world for me to be told by insurance companies that were bidding on my policy that I got all this time to live. Well, I told my kids, hey, I am going to live, but I don't want them to not say that I'm not going to live longer so I can sell the policy. I need the money. So I asked my Dr. Alberico, my cancer doctor, Dr. Alberico, and he wasn't very comfortable for, I said, can you write a letter saying that they're wrong? That, it, you know, he goes, I don't know how long you're going to live, Steve, you're doing great. And I said, no, I don't want you to say how long I'm going to live. I just want you to give them the statistics of what the averages are, the norms and with this type of cancer. And he wrote a letter, we appealed it. But they came back and denied the appeal. Well, the agent that was representing me said, hey, Steve, when they first denied it, he'd come back and I'll never forget how he said it. He said, Steve, I got some good news and bad news. And I said, well, okay, give me the good news first. And he said, the actuarials came back and said, you got 17 more years. And I said, well, that's great. And he goes, but the bad news is I can't sell your policy. And he said, if you ever have a change in your medical diagnosis for the worst, let me know and we'll try to do it again. Well, in 2016, I got diagnosed with prostate cancer and I called him up and said, hey, I got good news for you, not for me. And he said, what's that? And I said, now I got prostate cancer. He said, well, good. We can probably sell your policy. So it took about 6 months, sold the policy for a huge amount of money. He got a phenomenal commission. And I used those funds to support myself over the next couple of years while I continued to grow my foundation. In 2012, when I started Right Thinking Foundation, I was very committed. Now, I want to tie a couple things together and tell you this. When I first got my cancer diagnosis in 2001, my father and I had had this lifetime relationship where, you know, I was respectful and polite to him. I described it many times as it's more like an uncle that I just acknowledged and was nice to, but never much like a dad. We'd always had somewhat of a strange relationship. You know, I went back and reviewed a lot of these episodes, and I have acknowledged that I did learn a great deal from my dad earlier in life, even though I didn't enjoy it sometimes. One of the things that he used to tell me when I was very young, doing all that hitchhiking and dropping out of college and stuff, was he told me that I've got to be able to start to save money and have a fallback in case something ever happens and I'm going to need that fallback. Well, what's really beautiful here, and I want to give my dad a great acknowledgement here. My whole foundation, Right Thinking Foundation, financial literacy, it's based on the premise of getting on top of your finances, something that you can control in life because all the unexpected things that are going on in life come out of nowhere, accident, divorce, job layoff, et cetera, that we have no control over. We should get on top of things that we do. And if you can get on top of your finances and reduce stress in your life, you'll be able to deal with those other things that come out of nowhere that you have no control over. Well, that's my dad's whole philosophy that he tried to teach me when I was young, when I was out there just, you know, doing a whole lot of things, dropping out of college, hitchhiking around, et cetera. And so he was absolutely right about that. And it's kind of ironic that, you know, I was butting heads with my dad early out in life, but that he was right. And so now my foundation focuses on taking responsibility and making sure that you have good credit, saving so that you can, you know, have money for that rainy day and other things like that. But my dad was very instrumental in trying to push that on me when I was young. And you know, I knew that one day I'd be having a nice career and have more money. So I valued my free time and I learned to leverage early in my life. But every now and then I'd have a medical setback. It would put a lot of pressure on me. So I got real good at handling how to work out of a jam. Well, I told you in the last episode that I was going to talk a little bit more about my dad. And here's what I want to tell you. I learned love from my mother. I mean, that's my whole life story. My mother's just so important to me with everything. You know, I say she's, you know, never met a stranger, give anyone a shirt off her back, taught me how to love. Well, and she also, you know, was with me when we went to the Billy Graham revival and accepted Jesus. So, you know, you've heard all those stories of my life. But what I learned in my relationship with my dad, I learned forgiveness. And that's one of the most important things in life that we need to live and understand. You know, my dad, he was the youngest of 12 in a large family. And his father died when he was 2 years old. And so his other brothers and sisters basically raised him. And he went to Virginia Tech right before World War II. And then during World War II, he was out of college and was in the Navy. And then he went back to college afterwards and he worked all the time. He was a lineman for the power company up there in Blacksburg, Virginia. And he knew how to work. And good stories about when I was a kid. You know, I gave the eulogy at my dad's funeral later when he passed. But I learned so much from my dad. You might think this is kind of funny, but one of the main things I learned from my dad was how to pack the trunk of a car. You know, he was a mechanical engineer, and he got great awards from the United States Postal Service for designing containers that they could sort mail and do different things. He was an engineer, Virginia Tech engineer. But he had this personality that was, kind of like a perfectionist maybe, but he loved to do brain teasers and riddles and things like that. Always had, like some kind of a real dry joke. So I thought that I would just throw in one of my favorite jokes. It's very intelligent. I haven't given you a lot of jokes in this series. What is a pirate's favorite letter? What is a pirate's favorite letter? R, you say? Well, me likes the C. I call that a triple. It's got three different kind of points to it. But now that's my dad's personality that I share, that I just showed you and I demonstrated. But now what I want to tell you is that when I got diagnosed with my cancer, my dad called me on the phone every single day to have a, it was in the evenings, to talk with me for the first 6 months as I went through accepting that I had a terminal illness diagnosis that was incurable. And those conversations, they were incredible. We got everything worked out. He actually asked me to forgive him for not being there in my life when I was younger in a different way. And I asked him to forgive me too for being so rebellious and headstrong. But my dad got remarried to Doris. My dad's name was Sydney. He got remarried to Doris, and I took all those trips up there that I was forced to take on those bus rides when I was a kid to go spend Easter, Christmas, and 3 weeks in the summer. But Doris was really good to me. And they had a daughter named Dee, and she's 12 years younger than me. And when you're that much older than one of your siblings, sometimes they really look up to you. And Dee always treated me as a big brother that she really, really loved. And I love Dee. And so Dee's got a beautiful family, and got a wonderful husband and two beautiful kids. And all I want to say is that after my father died, she was an only child with my father and Doris. She was very concerned that my sister Arlene and I weren't going to have a whole lot to do with her just because, she was, from my father's second marriage. Well, it's turned out really good. We're closer than we've ever been our whole lives right now. And I just want to say, Dad, you did good bringing Dee into this world, and I love her. Okay. Well, so those conversations that my dad and I had those 6 months, they were really deep. And he asked me questions like, how are you, Steve? How are you handling this? I'd start to talk about it. But what it came down to, I remember in one of our conversations, was I gave him an explanation. I gave him an explanation of how I view what's going on in my life. And this was around the time that I was having a very hard time, grasping, everything that's happening here. But I told him, I said, well, Dad, just imagine this. I'm a 50-year-old and I've been catapulted into the senior years of my life. And I've had my middle age years erased. And I said, so, I just kind of look at it like that. And what that led into, though, was I established for myself an attitude that I was going to use whatever time I had left. And it wasn't necessarily going to just be 5.5 years or whatever the doctor said. I was going to use this time that I had left to do just the best possible things I could with my life. And I'd left the marina, 7 years later, 2008. And when I left the marina, I started that real estate deal. And during those same years, the real estate deal, it was semi full time. I could do other things at the same time. I went on a salary with my partners for that real estate deal in North Carolina. But I decided that, I don't know how much time I have left to live, I want to make a difference. Instead of working just for a profit in my life, I want to do nonprofit work. So I spent 3 years exploring other nonprofits that I could work with. And I liked all of them, but I quickly learned that I need to do my own, because I wanted to lead my own and not just be an employee working for someone else, following out what their vision or their mission might be. So that's when in 2012, I started Right Thinking Foundation. And what was so beautiful about it was that I went to New Life Christian Church. Don and I had been attending there, and Rodney was just an amazing person, and the other pastors were also. Well, right around this time, I had a very bad financial setback. I had the bank that I had been dealing with that had the second mortgage on my home. They had the senior people, five of the senior people were indicted for a lot of mishandling of funds, or I don't want to go into the details of the bank, but Don Price was one of the senior people there, and he left the bank because he wasn't part of it, and he became the main witness with the SEC to testify about the practices of the bank and so forth. And when the bank changed hands, they went from Bank of Commonwealth to Southern Bank. The new officer that handled my account after Don Price left, and Don Price is the same Don Price as one of my founding members of my board that's been one of my best, closest friends, a man that I truly love for 43 or so years now. He's part of my curriculum that I have through GTL that's in prisons across the country. He teaches with me on credit, how to establish, maintain, and build your credit. And so anyway, Don left, and the person that took his place came in, and the first thing they did was they told me I had 30 days to pay off my second mortgage. And we're talking about $250,000 on my second mortgage here. And that was impossible for me to do. I was in a startup company in Elizabeth City. Hadn't made, you know, got that off the ground too far. A couple years into that, not making good, real good money. And I had no choice. And so the long and the short of it is that when they went to call my loan, I couldn't pay it off. So I negotiated with them, and I did get a reprieve where I paid 1 year's worth of prepayments on the loan, and I put it in a bank account so I didn't have to worry about the loan not being current for a year. And they agreed that if I was able to increase my income dramatically, that I would be able to keep the loan in place. Well, I had a great year. I doubled my income. Everything was going great. And they still said they wanted me to pay off the loan. And well, long story short, one of my business partners co-signed the loan. We moved it to another bank. We followed Don Price to the new bank that he was at, got it refinanced there. And so that's what I did with that. But right during this time at New Life Christian Center, there are about 75, 80 people or so in the congregation that day. I gave a testimony in church asking for prayer. And I just told them about, I don't want to lose my house. I told them about the bank that was trying to force me to pay off a loan. And I asked for prayer. Immediately after the service, Steve and Fred, they were in the worship team. They came up to me and they said, "Man, we didn't know you were a business dude. You know, we can you help us?" And I said, help you do what? And they said, "Well, we got a barbershop. It's called Master's Touch." And they said, "And we just got our license to be able to have a barber school, and we'd like you to help us grow it." Well, fast forward through this whole thing. I went out to their school. I met them, and 8 of the 9 chairs that day were felons. And the first thing they said to me was, "Steve, could you get us into prisons and rehab centers?" And I did a Willis. "What you mean?" And they told me, "Well, see, that's where we started 25 years ago. We were in prison, and And Steve's story is chronicled and on my radio show. We've had some wonderful interviews. Staying Between the Lines is the name of the show that I did with Steve, where he does his testimony and tells about how he turned his life around, went to prison and so forth. But so I helped them, and one thing led to another, and I got them to where we got into where we could go to prisons. They wanted to help other people that were in prison when they come out be able to become barbers, because it's a wonderful career, very flexible. You can, a lot of opportunity. You can work out of your house. You can work in a shop. You can rent a chair, whatever. So I got involved in a lot of agencies, and I got into prison, and I went to St. Bride's Prison, and I went into what they call a resource fair, job fair. And so Steve went with me. We set up a booth, and we had five groups of men come through there for 50 minutes, 10 minute break, five of them with after the first couple, there was a big lunch break. That was my first experience in a prison. And during one of the breaks, right after 50 men, there was 300 men came through, five groups of 60 rather. After the 60 men had come through and we introduced them to the barbershop, and I got to know a lot of people, I was by myself for a minute there, and then I had an experience. And you hear about these kind of experiences from other people all the time, but it happened to me. All of a sudden, I looked up at the ceiling of the gymnasium in the prison where we were, and the ceiling wasn't there anymore. And I was looking up into the heavens, and God spoke to me. And he told me this is what he wants me to do. He wants me to dedicate myself to helping these people that are incarcerated to have a better life. And I remember, I will never forget this. I said, so this is what you want me to do? Well, it makes perfect sense. I love everybody. And I've got the background and the ability to come in here and not be afraid and help people, where I can use my financial background and my personal skills. And I said, I accept it, Lord. And so that's how I got started. And then I came back to St. Bride and put together my financial literacy program. And I've been doing it for 9 years, been in prisons, you know, hundreds and hundreds of times. Now it's a national program. And so I just want to share just a couple fun experiences for you. While my prison experiences, I think the best one is this. I always wear a white shirt and the same necktie. I have two suits, a brown suit and a charcoal suit that I always was wearing and whenever I'd go do my seminars and workshops in prisons. And I was at Brunswick Women's Work Center in Lawrenceville, Virginia. And I told them one day, just hit me, that I needed to explain to these women. There were about 55 women in there that day. And I said, hey, I want to explain something to you. You know, I wear the same thing every time you see me. I've always got a white shirt, never checked stripes or anything else, never a color, white shirt, same tie with my brown suit or same tie with my charcoal suit. And I just want you to know why I do that. And I said, y'all need consistency in your lives. And I want to be consistent. I want y'all to know that every time Steve comes here, he's going to be consistent in your lives. His message is going to be consistent, that he loves you. He's here to help you. And I said, so I just want to let you know that I'm not trying to impress anybody with, you know, GQ fashion or anything. A woman in the back raised her hand and was waving it. And I said, yes, ma'am. And she says, that's okay, Mr. Coplon. We wear the same clothes every day too. That's my favorite little anecdote when I was in prisons. Well, the program that I started on personal finance, small business ownership, where I teach people how to really keep track of what their spending is and how to get their priorities in order and so forth, it had evolved into doing a program called Converting Canteen Spending to Savings that the counselor at Brunswick, Reginald Ponton, had asked me what I do. And that came after a young lady. My programs went like this. I would do a couple of weeks of seminars on personal finance, small business ownership, just basics on how to handle money and all those things and what you need if you're going to try to start a business, how money really works in your life. And then anybody that finished that was thinking about starting their own business. And by a show of hands, usually about 50% of people that are incarcerated want to start their own business. A lot of them for the wrong reasons, because they don't think they can get a job working for anybody else. And so, you know, I teach them the fundamentals of what you got to have in place to start your own business. You got to have credit. You got to have some working capital savings behind you there. Sales always come in slower. Expenses are always higher. And you're going to need more than what you think to sustain and survive. So anyway, if somebody went all the way through my seminar on personal finance, small business ownership, they qualified to be in my next workshop for starting your own business. And it was a seminar called The Business Plan. And so after they went through the business plan, I would give them individual one-on-one counseling where they talk about what they want to do when they get out. Then I would do research because they don't have the use of computers to do research and things. And so I've done to date probably 450 to 500 research projects for returning citizens all over the country, helping them get information on whatever choices they might make. And I've put together a lot of materials on how to start your own business checklists and things like that. And but this one young lady came up to me in the one-on-one session, and she was about 23 years old. And I said to her, "What can I do for you?" And she said, "I'm scared to death. I'm getting out in 6 weeks, and I don't want to go back to the environment that I came. I don't know how to handle money. Can you teach me how to handle my money?" And I said, "Yes, I can." And so she told me that she lived at home, went to college, got pregnant. Then she moved in with her boyfriend. They got arrested for drug dealing. She was an accomplice or an accessory. She was serving a 2-year sentence. Her parents were raising her daughter that was now 5 years old. And she said she did not want to live with her parents for the rest of her life. She wanted to be able to handle her own responsibilities. And she had never seen the father of the child again once she was incarcerated. Well, that was what she was facing in her life. And I said, "I can help you. I do want to help you. But, you know, everybody else here needs the same thing on how to handle their money. And let me talk to Mr. Ponton and see what we can do." So I went to Mr. Ponton and I told him, "Can I start a personal budget course?" He said, "Absolutely. Absolutely, Steve. I would love that." And he said, "But let me ask you this. Could you teach them how to handle their canteen spending so that it would help them save more? And then when they get out, that would be just a discipline, a skill that would help them for the rest of their lives." So that's how I developed converting canteen spending to saving. And it was basically endorsed, by the state of Virginia that asked me to do it. And that's the best teachings that I have, because I teach people how to focus on their priorities, eliminate distractions, and just pay attention. And I got a one-page worksheet that if you do that one-page worksheet, it'll help you really focus on things that you're not doing right. And then you can start to make the changes. Anyway, there was a woman named Cynthia, and there's a place called the Virginia Diner. That's kind of like a real institution in Virginia. Some of the best Smithfield ham and home cooked vegetables. They got a carrot souffle that's to die for. So they have a buffet. And, you know, they sell peanuts and gift items and things. Well, my father, probably he was about 87 or 8 years old, and he had a girlfriend. And Donna's parents, Ed and Agnes and I, the six of us, went to the Virginia Diner for a Sunday afternoon buffet once. And when we got in there and got all seated, and I walked up to take a look at the buffet to see if I wanted to order off order off the menu, a woman behind the buffet line that was putting food on it, she said, Mr. Coplon, do you remember me?" And I did. Her name was Cynthia. And I said, "I do. Hi, Cynthia. How are you doing?" She goes, "I'm doing great, Mr. Coplon." She says, "There's six of us here from Brunswick." And she goes, "Mr. Coplon, your program works. We're all using it. I've saved $800 in the last 2 months. And Susie, she saved $2,000. She goes, "Your program works. It's wonderful." You talk about feeling good. it just did my heart joy. And then she went in the back, and all six of them weren't working that day, but three of them were. And so I had a reunion with a couple of them, and it was just so wonderful. I met the management of the restaurant, and they got introduced to me they said, these are the best employees we have. They are so focused. We just love having employees come to us from that prison because they're always good. They're always motivated. Well, that was just another one of my wonderful stories, to know that the work that I do is helping people. And so that's kind of sharing a little bit of the good times of the prison work. The last anecdotal story that I'd like to share, I think, is one of the most single important ones that I have to offer. I went out to my daughter's in Oregon. I went cross country and I drove, and you know, I love going cross country. In a moment after I tell this story, I'm going to tell some of my travel experiences that I've had with my wife and then some with Josh. But I would go to Baker City, Oregon, which was the capital of the Oregon Trail back in the days, one of my favorite parts of history, the Lewis and Clark expeditions, and then the Oregon Trail, people that left everything they had in the East Coast for a new life and got a land grant out in the Midwest somewhere to clear the rocks off the soil and start growing crops so that we could have what we call the breadbasket of America to feed the populations in the East. Well, I would go to Baker City to a prison there called Powder River Correctional. It's kind of a long story, but when I first got my radio show, Richard Kay, which is a person that I met at another church that had a similar background, he was also Jewish in life, and then he later became a pastor, and we became really close friends. He had a radio show, an international radio show. He got me on a show, said, you're a natural. You ought to have your own show. He went searching and he found a man named Jeff Heiser that had a show called Success and Intentional Lifestyle. He interviewed me, said he'd give me a show. So I got set up there. Jeff Heiser, he had gone out to Oregon. He introduced me to people out in Oregon. I got set up on my next trip to go visit my daughter, to go out to the prison at Powder River Correctional Facility. And I started a program there. I've been there 5 or 6 times now. I love it. Chaplain Hafer is my contact there. He's a wonderful man. Robert Miller is an inmate there that got out recently, and I mentored him and got beautiful correspondence from him. And he taught me something, that education is the number one deterrent to fight recidivism. And he asked me to help him if he could get a scholarship to go to correspondence school, or what they call distance learning. Adams State's the number one in the country. Adams State University Distance Learning Center. A week before I got the letter from him, he said, Steve, I know your financial circumstances. I know you're not going to be able to help me, but maybe you could just help me get a scholarship. Well, my father had left a $2,000 insurance policy, my share of it, he was a World War II veteran, as I said. And you know what I did? I've had so much frustration trying to get support for my foundation. The few people that have totally supported me, I would like to thank right now. One of them doesn't want to be acknowledged publicly, but I've got one donor that's been with me for the whole 9 years, a beautiful person, and I thank him for that. He knows who I'm speaking at. And Marty Einhorn, one of my closest friends in life. I knew him ever since he was a teenager. I was close with his parents, and when I did all of the studying of the Old Testament, the 5 books of Moses, Lois and Barry Einhorn, 2 wonderful people. Their son Marty. Marty was the accountant when I was at CI Travel. We spent 10 years together, 9.5 years there doing that. He later became one of the senior partners, Wall Einhorn Insurance, or CPA firm in Norfolk, one of the best places to work in Hampton Roads. Well, Marty's my hero. Marty became a founding board member of Right Thinking Foundation. He's been on boards of many, many organizations. Unfortunately, Marty passed a couple of months ago, and it's a huge loss to the community. But Marty's CPA firm supported my foundation for a number of years, took care of printing my materials for me. And Marty, though, developed a cancer, and I already had my cancers, as you know. And Marty called me when he first got his cancer and asked me a whole lot about it. And anyway, we were close. He fought his cancer valiantly. He went through a procedure called CAR-T and was announced got rid of the cancer, but then he caught another cancer and then eventually took his life. Well, I don't know what else I can say right now other than, Marty, I love you, and you've done so much for everyone, and your life was that of a true saint, and God bless you and your family. Well, so anyway, I took the $2,000 of the proceeds of my father's insurance policy that I'd got, and I just donated to put the first semester of Robert Miller's tuition together. And I think we actually got through three semesters. I raised a little bit of money for him and he got out, but he's doing wonderfully well. And so thank you, Robert, for letting me be part of your life. But, you know, a lot of people have programs where they have scholarships from endowments and things and just put many, many people through school. Well, I want to do more of that, but to date, I've just done Robert Miller, but at least I got a chance to do that. I figured, you know, what am I going to do with the $2,000? I need it to pay bills, but Robert's going to do better with it than I can. So that's what I did with that. Well, the whole point that I'm trying to make right now, the last time before the pandemic that I went to Powder River Correctional Facility, I flew. It was in November of 2019. And when I got to the prison, the first 20 minutes, I had about 80 some men there. The first 20 minutes of the visit, I really talked about hardships in life, and I gave a whole lot of my testimony, and I was just really going hard. And when I finished that part of my seminar, a man in the back raised his hand and he said, "Steve, with all the hardship that you've just talked about that you're going through, are you happy with your life?" And I gave him this answer. I said, "Let me tell it to you like this." I said, "Little Stevie Copeland grew up at 450 Thole Street in Norfolk, Virginia, and he went to Suburban Park Elementary School, and then he graduated from Granby High School. And then later in life, he caught an airplane and he flew all the way to Portland, Oregon. And as he flew on that airplane, you can picture a map, like a cartoon map from a Disney cartoon, of a map of the United States. And every state that he flew over, a little red light comes on to show that he's crossed over that state. And he landed in Portland and rented a car, and he drove 5 hours due east along the Columbia River, the Columbia River Gorge, and he came to Baker City, and he came inside Powder River Correctional Facility. And he was welcomed, received, and loved by all of you in such a way that it's the most wonderful feeling that a person can experience when he's loved as much as he's loved. What I want to tell you, am I happy? I'm the happiest man in the world. I am the most blessed man in the world for the life that I've given. Regardless of all the hardship, the Lord is using me and putting me in places that I am just thankful for. So, yes, that's my answer to you. And then after that, they're very receptive to everything I had to say, and we went from there. What I want to talk about next is to transition this. I want to get back to the time that I was getting close to my dad. Oh, we got really close those last years of his life. He was a remarkable man. He lived to be 95 years old, and he would have gone further, but he ended up going into an assisted living home, and his mind was 100%. He was totally mobile. And after about 3 weeks where he was in a wheelchair and we didn't know why, it had a sudden turn for the worse, we took him to an emergency room and they did x-rays and they said he had a broken hip from about 3 weeks earlier. They could tell by the healing of the bones. Well, that was just an unbelievable situation. He went from being we'd say 100% to he never recovered. He had to go in for surgery for a broken hip. And I was with him with my sisters during the last days of his life. And he never came out of the hospital. But I do want to share this with you. My dad and I, we loved each other. We forgave each other. And he told me what I think every son wants to hear from his dad. He said, "Stevie, I'm really proud of what you've done with your life, what you're doing with your foundation and everything else you've done. I'm just so proud of you. You're the best son a father could ever have." Well, thank you, Dad. You know, when my mother passed, it'd be 23 years ago, and I was the executor of her estate, my mother gave me a similar compliment. Meant so much to me. In her will, she didn't have a whole lot. She didn't have a couple $1,000s worth of value, a little bit of jewelry, some nice sweaters and things. She left a couple $1,000s, I think, to one of my sisters and some of her clothes, a little bit of jewelry. We worked it out so that my sister Abby got to take over the interest in the house, and we worked it out so that Abby would take care of her father and my share of the house that my father had left to me and my sister. We gave it to my sister Abby so she could live there. But right in my mother's will, she said to my son Steve, "He doesn't really need anything. I'm so proud of what he's done with his life. And I just leave him, you know, my music collection." She had a whole lot of cassette tapes that I've talked about before, Mitch Miller music and all that good stuff. Well, you know, I've had a wonderful life. And I've got, like I said, 8 grandkids. My children are beautiful. I'm proud of them. My 3 kids are all entrepreneurs. Lindsay's got her tie-dye. Andrew's got his consulting into the craft beer industry. That's a national company now and doing wonderfully well. And Josh is doing the music industry, the kayaks. Well, they've learned something from me, because I used to say, if I were to die now, and this was 30 years back, what do you want to, you know, I used to ask this question. If you were to die all of a sudden, what would you like to make sure that you passed on to your kids? And the answer to that question for me was enthusiasm. They'll get through life if they've got an enthusiasm, a joy of living. Politeness, if they can be polite to everybody and be respectful, they're gonna do well. And smile. If they can have a warmth about themselves, they don't have to have much else. They don't have to have money, education, or much of anything. But if they can be enthusiastic, polite, and smile, they should do real well in life. That's been kind of what I've done in my life. I've battled a lot of adversity, but I've also had some of the most joyous, wonderful times imaginable. And so what I'd like to share with you right now is, you know, I like travel. You know that I've spent a great deal of my life involved in a lot of travel. And so what I want to do right this minute, I want to let you know more of what I've said. Despite all the hardships and adversity that I've had to go through, some self-created, I'll say, but a lot of it through just the unexpected medical battles that I've had. I've shared about how I met Donna. And when Donna and I first met, one of the things that we knew we were going to enjoy in our marriage was she had never had the opportunity to travel much. And I had traveled a lot. I've been to some of the most romantic places in the world by myself. I mean, I just traveled a lot and I love travel. But we knew we were going to do a lot of travel together. And so I'm going to read a little bit of this travel here. And I've got it mixed in to some of the things I did by myself and some of them with Donna. But I'll try to pull out what Donna and I did first. We went to New York maybe 30 times in the first 6 or 7 years of our marriage to see baseball games and Broadway shows. I think we did at least 30 Broadway shows. Here, let me see if I can do it in order. She went cross country with me. We went to California cross country. We drove the California coastline. We did Yellowstone National Park, Mount Rushmore, Custer State Park. We saw buffaloes and prairie dogs. We went through the Badlands in South Dakota. We went to Galena in Illinois. We went to Dubuque, Iowa, Botanical Gardens. We saw Shoshone Falls, Sioux Falls, the Grand Tetons, the Freedom Trail in Boston. We built snowmen in Central Park and New York City after the Valentine's Day record-breaking snow. I think it was 27 or 8 inches. We've been to a World Series baseball game. I saw a C.C. Sabathia pitch in 1999 against the Phillies. We went down to South Carolina and toured down there, saw some beautiful plantations and where the old cotton mills were. Been to Myrtle Beach. We played a lot of golf together. We went to Colorado. We went into the Rocky Mountain National Forest. We saw the aspen forest there. We went looking. We saw a herd of elk in the forest there. That was amazing, looking for moose. We tried to find some moose. We went to Tennessee to Cades Cove, where there's an 18-mile history loop that was wonderful. We did a hike that had at least a quarter miles of just a path. There was nothing but the most beautiful rhododendrons imagined. When we were out visiting with Lindsay, we went to Crater Lake in Oregon. We went to the Biltmore Estate in North Carolina. We climbed Chimney Rock. We did the Asheboro Zoo. We did the Washington, D.C. Zoo. We went to the Peaks of Otter. We saw the Natural Bridge. We went to Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and Amish country. We've seen ranches in Wyoming. We did Niagara Falls in Toronto. We went cross country through Canada, came in through Sault Ste. Marie to Mackinac Island. We went Jordan Lake kayaking there, and that's where Josh first kayaked and set the seed for him to go into having a kayak rental company. We did drive that California coastline. We went to Carmel, California, Monterey. We saw Cannery Row, where the famous John Steinbeck book. John Steinbeck's my favorite writer in my life. We went to Pebble Beach. We saw the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge. We saw the giant redwoods. We saw Big Sur. We did the Hearst Mansion. We hiked all through Tennessee, as I said. We did Mount Washington, New Hampshire, where there is the world's most severe weather. We drove the auto road. We went on Charles Stanley Christian Cruise to Alaska. We saw the Sawyer Twin Glaciers. We went up to on the Mindenhall Glacier and drove where they have Iditarod dogs, and we drove a dog sled up there near Juneau. We went to Dollywood and enjoyed all the music there, the gospel music there. We saw the Kingdom Heirs there, and they were on the Charles Stanley Christian Cruise, and we went on excursion and got to know them. We went to Europe with Josh on a senior field trip. I took Andrew and Lindsay and Josh and Melissa. And we just had a most wonderful time while we were there. There's three, you know, I studied counting at an art history school at VCU, and I must have pulled 10,000 slides from my friends. And I learned that I think the three greatest works of art paintings in the world are Da Vinci's The Mona Lisa, El Greco's Count Orthe Ascending into Heaven, and the Rembrandt The Night Watch. Well, we saw two of those on that trip. I'd seen the El Greco when I went to Toledo, Spain on a field trip when I was working in CI Travel years earlier. But we went to the Anne Frank Museum. We also saw windmills and Holland. When we were in Paris, we went to the Moulin Rouge. We had dinner in the Eiffel Tower. In London, we did the Buckingham Palace. We saw Big Ben, the Tower of London, where the crown jewels are. We went to the Queen's Theater and saw Les Miserables. Donna slept through the whole thing. I got to put that in there because that's one of the funniest things that we like to laugh about. She was so tired. We had second row seats, and she was gone in 2 minutes. There was so much more we did. Once we had a beautiful trip, vacation plan to go to Italy, to see Italy and go to Venice and Florence and those things. And I had to cancel that trip because I had to start cancer treatments. One of the highlights in recent years was we're not Vegas type people, but we love Donny and Marie Osmond. When the first conversation Donna and I ever had, she talked about how she was in love as a teenager, a 12-year-old with Donny Osmond. And I told her that Marie Osmond was one of my favorites. So we had that in common. Well, they had a nightclub show, and it was going to be their last show in November this past year. So 2 years ago, rather, because the coronavirus wasn't this past year. And so I surprised her for an anniversary present. And in September, our anniversary is in July, But I bought tickets for us to go to Las Vegas and had tickets to the Donnie Marie Osmond shows the last 5 weeks or so of their run there. And while we were there, we went to see the Grand Canyon and the Hoover Dam and Route 66. And so we had a really big vacation about 5 or 6 years ago. We went to Tahiti and we spent 2 weeks on that trip. And we did a lot of the islands in Tahiti. And South Pacific is one of my all-time favorite movies with its soundtrack. And this, you know, it's the song Bailey High. We went right there and got photographs of Bailey High, where that mount, you know, where that island in the movie is sung about. What I want to tell you is that I've just had a wonderful life. Donna, when she married me, she knew about my diagnosis, didn't fully understand it though, but was willing to go for it, willing to get whatever time we could share together. And so that's what we started doing, just enjoying our life together. But it wasn't always easy as I was developing, you know, building the nonprofit. No money in nonprofits. So let me tell you that before you think about doing it. And then I sold that insurance policy to live off of for a couple of years. But there was a time in there we had to put the house on the market to downsize because we didn't think we'd be able to afford to keep the house that we live in. Three different times we had to list it with an agent. We didn't like that. I fought really hard. But once I came to Donna, probably about 5, 6 years as a nonprofit, and I said, sweetheart, I'm sorry to be putting you through this struggle that we're constantly in. Do you want me to just get a regular job and stop moving forward with the nonprofit because it's just too hard financially? And she said, Steve, I know that's your calling. And the Lord never would have given it to you if it wasn't going to be successful. So, no, keep doing it. And we're not going to worry about it. The Lord's going to take care of us. So I kept doing it. And the Lord does take care of me. One of the things that he did was he led me into a company. Gary, my racquetball buddy at the Y that I was playing racquetball with, he ended up being involved in a company that needed some accounting, and he brought me in. And long story short, I never wanted to go back into consulting and work in a corporate environment, but Heritage Wealth Management Group, they're godly people, they're beautiful, they needed me. I did my consulting for a year and a half there. They didn't want to let me go. They brought me in as the chief finance officer on a permanent basis, and we're helping to grow that company. But I never would have done it if the people there, Mark and Margie and Peter, weren't beautiful, godly people. I love being with them, and that saved me the financial struggles that I've been going through. That stabilized me. They know that my work with Right Thinking Foundation is my main focus, but they accept that. And GTL is moving forward with me with my curriculum. That's going well. Got a new wonderful opportunity with Clemmer Associates, a leadership, international leadership organization. I'm doing consulting for them to help them bring their resources into prisons. And I couldn't ask for more beautiful things to happen in life. It's wonderful. I do want to tell you that when I was doing my hitchhiking all those years back, I had had a story that I believe I shared about Merle the cowboy. And when I was hitchhiking through Silt, Colorado, after I left Herb Wong's New China Cafe on my way to California. Well, when I drove cross country a couple years back by myself, and then Josh flew out there and met me at Lindsay's and then came home with me. I went back to Silt. It had been over 40 years. So it's pretty neat to be traveling in some places you never think you'll see again and then go back to them. And on that trip, I went to Willow River State Park. Saw the most beautiful waterfalls that I've ever seen, took the most beautiful photograph I've ever taken in my life. I've been to all 50 states now. And the last state that I hadn't been to was North Dakota. And so Leffert Fate, he had a very close friend named John Hagen that's head of medical services in the state of North Dakota in the prison system. He introduced me. And so I got an invite into North Dakota prisons. And I saved the best state for last. I was treated royally there. I just love going to the prisons in North Dakota and making friends with John Hagen. He's been just wonderful. He's the one that introduced me to GTL. Yeah, that's been beautiful. I went to Montana, to Little Bighorn. I've traveled the forest in Oregon. I've been to Painted Hills, John Day Fossil Beds. When I was in Tulsa, Oklahoma, where I went to see Jim Stovall at the Oral Roberts University, they've got the world's largest praying hands. Praying hands are so important in my life. I remember stopping at Stuckey's when I was riding my motorcycles back in college and bought a nightlight of the praying hands to give to the Sprouls, my adopted grandparents across the street that first really helped me start to get into the word of the Lord there. And that thing in Tulsa at Oral Roberts University, I said it's 60 feet high and it weighs 30 tons made out of bronze. I drove the Sheldon Wildlife National Refuge in Nebraska. I didn't get there till 11:30 at night, and it took me 125 miles, and it was the most desolate place I've ever been in my life. I'm glad I didn't run out of gas. I've driven on the Bonneville Salt Flats in Salt Lake City, Utah. I went to the Nelson Morley Birds of Prey in Idaho on the Snake River. I saw a peregrine falcon there. I went to Craters of the Moon in Idaho, where they train astronauts for what it'd be like to be on the moon. And I have just had a life of meeting people. No one is a stranger in my life. I've just had wonderful things. I do not want you to think that my life is nothing but adversity. You know, it's not. My life is full of joy and people. But here's kind of what I want to say as we end this show in a few minutes. My life is at a place now where I believe that my relationship with the Lord is one where I fully trust Him. I honestly don't have fear of what the future is going to bring. I know that if I just keep walking in line with the Lord's steps, I will have a wonderful life to be continued. A couple weeks ago, Emma, one of our granddaughters, Melissa's daughter in North Carolina, she colored a page out of a coloring book that has got scripture, and this is from Proverbs 16:9. We can make our plans, but the Lord determines your steps. Absolutely. So as I sum up today's show and I bring it to a close, there's one thing that I neglected to bring up earlier. When I first decided to form my own nonprofit, Right Thinking Foundation, and I'm just absolutely thrilled that I've got from the U.S. Patent Office the words Right Thinking. I have those words patent in my name as it relates to financial literacy education. Right thinking are biblical words. Righteousness, good thinking. Well, I have a quote that I'd like to share with you. My potential is higher than my needs. That's in my curriculum. It's right there with Winston Churchill. If you're going through hell, keep going. And the second verse of that is, and you'll get through hell so fast that the devil won't even know you've been there. Keep going. Maya Angelou, quote, you may encounter many defeats, but you must not be defeated. In fact, it may be necessary to encounter the defeats so you can know who you are, what you can rise from, how you can still come out of it. Mahatma Gandhi, the best way to find yourself is to lose yourself in service to others. When I first started Right Thinking Foundation, I wrote down on two little cards, backs of business cards. I put them in my wallet. And every time I ever go into prison, I put these two cards in my top pocket right over my heart. One of them is, Jesus, I am your servant. And the second one is, the Lord is good to me. And that is from Johnny Appleseed, the Disney. I told Donna, I just want to be the Johnny Appleseed. 9 years ago, I set out to be the Johnny Appleseed that goes around to prisons and meets people to help them have a better life, to fight recidivism, to keep them out of prison and keep their kids out. Well, I believe that I'm doing that, but I have to explain this as I sign off. This is really going to be it for now. It's not about anything that I've ever done. It's not about what my goals are. It's not about what my accomplishments are. It's not about all the hardships that I picked myself up from. Those are just what we call motivational, inspirational type things that I share with you. But it's something far different than that. And what it really is it's about having a personal relationship with the Lord and setting your desire on knowing the Lord. He knows everything you ever asked for. He knows what you want. But when you get to where you fully trust him and not think about whatever it is that you want, and you serve him, he's gonna put you where you belong, and he's going to take care of you. That relationship is all that really matters. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is called the love chapter in the New Testament. Verse 3, if I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Verse 7, it's talking about love. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. In the last verse from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that I think we all should take to heart. And now these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Well, I just want to tell you right now that the Beatles have been my favorite group my whole life. This book basically has been sharing with you my long and winding road. And I want to tell you that their song, The End, the love you take is equal to the love you make. Thank you for letting me share my life with you. I hope that you gain value from it. I'm always here for you, rightthink.org. Just reach out and I'll be there for you. And I just want to tell you this. Don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless each one of you. Have a great week.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.